I'm Michael Smerconish in Philadelphia. He hugged me too. October 28, 2016, I'd flown to St. Louis to interview Joe Biden on the campaign trail in the waning days of the Trump-Clinton race. Several things were memorable. The then VP had just made news saying that if he and Trump were in high school, he'd take him behind the gym and beat the hell out of him. And the FBI had just announced new Clinton server evidence found while investigating Anthony Weiner for sexting a 15-year-old girl. Biden made news when he said this.
Oh, God. Oh. Anthony Weiner. I should not comment on Anthony Weiner. I'm not a big fan.
Something else that stands out. When we first saw one another, before the cameras rolled, we embraced. I don't know which of us initiated it, probably him, because I'm not usually the huggy type. Even so, it seemed natural, despite the fact that I'm not particularly close to Joe Biden. Our paths have crossed several times over the years, and even though he's from Delaware and I'm from Pennsylvania, I've always thought of him as a Philly guy. That doesn't mean I haven't criticized him when I thought it appropriate. I know what some of you are thinking. Yeah, but you're a man. And that's true. And I don't seek to minimize the feelings of women who believe he was too close for their comfort. If they think it, then he was. I only wish to suggest that this is how he is with men and women. And with Biden, there's nothing hidden nor prurient about it. In his half century of public service, he's touched literally tens of thousands of men and women. In all that time, there's been not a whiff of personal scandal about him. Joe Biden's deficiencies don't include the lack of moral compass. Take a look at this picture. It's not staged. My radio producer, TC, took it on an iPhone when we were in the midst of conversation. Close talking, knee to knee, like a barroom dialogue. That's the way he is. When the interview ended, I returned my producer's favor. That's her with him. Note the same closeness. Look, there are reasons not to support Joe Biden for president, but his tactile nature isn't one of them. As always, I want to know what you think. Go to my website at smerconish.com. Answer this survey question. Is anything that has recently emerged about Joe Biden disqualifying for a presidential run? Joining me now to discuss, New York Times columnist Frank Bruni, who wrote this piece, Mayor Pete is plenty gay, and Democrats better not eat their own. Frank, you said that Joe Biden should not run for president, not because of the recent allegations. I wonder if anything that's transpired in the last few days has changed your view.
Well, I mean, the allegations that Lucy Flores and other women levied, I don't think those are nullifying for all the reasons you stated so eloquently in your intro right there. The one thing that gives me pause, in addition to the things that have always given me pause, it was Joe Biden's appearance before union workers on Friday. I'm not sure what he thought was gained by making jokes about the allegations against him. It's one thing to say, I'm not going to apologize for something that had no ill intent. I'm not going to apologize for a kind of behavior that for many decades no one questioned and that doesn't come with, as you said, other kinds of personal scandal. It still doesn't mean he should make light of it. And it made me wonder how this is going to play out, if he is going to sort of act somewhat almost resentful that he went through it. Now, the media has put him through a feeding frenzy that I think, you know, we do a disservice to ourselves and we do a disservice to the nominating process. But it still is not a good strategic idea for Joe Biden to make light of this.
I'm so glad you brought this up because there was something about that moment that occurred to me. Let's roll the tape and then we'll talk more.
I just want you to know I had permission to hug Lonnie. I don't know, man.
Frank, those union workers roared in approval. And to me, I wondered if that was a reflection of them thinking, saying, hey, enough already with the Democratic apology tour.
Yes, I think it was. And it also needs to be said that audience, I think, was mostly white, mostly male, and that factors in that. But yes, I think people are saying, and I got a lot of this reaction when I wrote what I did, you know, let's vet candidates, but let's not cannibalize them. Let's not hold human beings to a standard of perfection that's unattainable. Let's not forget that some people grew up in a culture of 40 or 30 or 20 years ago that was quite different. And let's not lose track of human messiness, which everyone has. I think in that applause, you heard people saying all of that. It still doesn't mean it's a great idea strategically or in terms of sensitivity for Joe Biden to say what he said. There are women out there who were put off by his behavior, who felt it was inappropriate and even demeaning. We need to be respectful of their feelings, and there's a way for him to do that without going on an apology tour, but on the flip side, without making light of what they've said about him.
Here's part of what you said in your recent column. How do Democrats properly vet their candidates for president without cannibalizing them? How do they rightly insist on sensitive and inclusive leaders while making allowances for past mistakes, present quirks, human messiness, and the differences in the conversation and the culture now versus 10 or 20 or 40 years ago? That's emerging as a central challenge of the Democratic presidential primary, and it's worrying me. And you were very Pete Buttigieg focused in terms of what you said, because there was actually an opinion piece that questioned whether he's gay enough, which made Frank Bruni wonder, is Kamala Harris black enough? I mean, where does it end, right?
Well, I mean, it has to end because on the Republican side of the aisle, you have a person, Donald Trump, who is forgiven for everything, who makes apologies for nothing. I mean, the amount of slack the Republicans have granted him is, quite frankly, morally unconscionable. But if the Democrats, meantime, are losing all sight of the line between a job interview and an inquisition, it is not going to play out well in terms of the most important business at hand, which is making sure Donald Trump is a one-term president. And I think right now Democrats are wrestling with this. I think on the far left, sometimes you have people who are staging complaints that are outside the realm of reality. Some of what's going on, Michael, that we haven't talked about that I think we need to recognize is a lot of this is fanned by rival campaigns. You don't see it out in the open. But when people are asking questions about a Pete Buttigieg or a Kamala Harris, or for that matter, a Bernie Sanders, often a lot of this is being pushed by their competitors in what is a crowded and an incredibly, incredibly intense primary in the making.
Well, and to circle back to where we began, relative to Joe Biden, some of the women who've come forward are, in fact, aligned with presidential candidates not named Biden already.
That is correct. Lucy Flores was a Bernie Sanders supporter in the past. Apparently, she was at Beto's announcement rally. Now, that doesn't mean everything she said didn't come from the heart and that her real concern was making sure that Joe Biden changes behavior going forward. But these are data points or pieces of information you have to integrate into your analysis of what's going on.
Look, I said at the outset, if they perceived him as being too close, then he was.
Yes.
And he needs to learn from that. But I too, do not believe it should be a disqualifier.